We would like to welcome you to the intersections of juvenile justice, understanding and implementing collaborative and culturally responsive practices for programs serving youth survivors of sex trafficking. My name is Joy Thompson, and I am the Director of Programs for Building Community and Liberation here at Youth Collaboratory. Our community today is filled with service providers from all across the youth services and juvenile justice systems, drop-in centers, street outreach, and many, many more. Again, welcome. Happy Black History Month. Happy Black Girl Freedom Week, and we look forward to growing and learning with all of you all today. And with that, I'm going to pass it to my colleagues, Lenore and Daisha.
Thank you, Joy. Welcome, everyone. We are just so excited to be in community with you all today. I'm going to pass to Daisha for us to do some introductions in the chat.
Yes, thank you so much. I'm Deja Petway. I'm our Training Capacity Building Manager here at Youth Collaboratory in our Liberation Team Focus Area. So if we can please add your name, your pronouns, your organization, your location and role in the chat, and just what is one thing that you're hoping to learn today, and just really to see who is in community with us today. We also encourage you to be on cameras, but please, as Joy stated, please stay muted, and also using the chat feature also really out, but just a reminder that chats are never fully private, and you know, when this ends, we will have those direct messages, so just keeping that in mind as we use the chat back and forth. And also, this meeting is being recorded as well. So I see we have some folks from, oh, this is going really fast, Rochester, New York. we have, hello, because we have some Colorado in the house. This is Pittsburgh, Buffalo, New York. So we are have Michigan, shout out. That's where I'm from, Michigan myself. California, yes, Texas, yes. This is going really too fast for me. So I encourage y'all to keep dropping in the chat. We always love to see who we are in. And I'll pass it to Lenore.
Thank you so much, Daisha. And again, my name is Lenore. Full name, Kanisha Lenore Jean-Baptiste, and my pronouns are she and her. I'm a training and capacity building manager with Youth Collaboratory. So again, welcome to you all, and thank you for being in community with us. Youth Collaboratory serves organizations and professionals working to improve the lives of young people, their families, and communities across the nation. We harness the power of youth service community to innovate, evaluate, and drive effective strategies that assure the safety and well-being of youth and young people, unlocking their unlimitless potential. Our work focuses on three primary areas, and that first area is our coordinated community response to youth and young adult experiencing homelessness, and that is our housing justice innovation. We also focus on our preventing and addressing relationship violence, sexual exploitation, and trafficking of youth, and that is through our liberation focus area. Finally, we have our supporting opportunities for young people to build community with family, peers, and others to enhance their assets, exploring their strengths, and develop lasting connections. And this is through community building and mentorship. And that is our community building focus area. So to learn more about Youth Collaboratory, please visit our website at www.youthcollaboratory.org. And I am now going to pass it over to Joy.
Thank you so much, Lenore. If you are interested in becoming a member of Youth Collaboratory, there are quite a few benefits that you have: 25% off of our webinars, up to 25% off of training and consulting services, and also access to sub-grant contracts. So lots of cool things, and you can find out more about that at the website that Lenore shared with you, and also at the link pictured here on the screen. So just a little bit more about Youth Collab. So specifically this project and what brings us here today is the specific focus on preventing trafficking of girls. What we are working on is the support of prevention and early intervention services, including mentoring and other direct support services for girls who are at risk of or are victims of sex trafficking. Grantees participate in peer-to-peer learning, scaling up of prevention and intervention strategies, and implementation and enhancement efforts to identify and provide services to girls impacted by sex trafficking. Through the Youth Collaboratory approach, we work to develop and utilize an assessment tool to establish equity baselines and benchmarks for youth services delivery. We address the prevalence and persistence of racism and ethnic bias that continue to shape these practices. And we are always informed and co-led by those with lived expertise. We focus on Black girls specifically in prevention work because Black girls are often punished, marginalized, and left out by the very institutions that can or should protect them. And also, they're disproportionately impacted by trafficking. Normalizing the centering of Black girls in prevention and intervention efforts positively impacts all youth at risk or currently being victimized by sex trafficking. With that, we welcome you to this presentation with our amazing partners, the Center for Court Innovation, and I will pass it on to our colleague, Brittany.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much, Joy. My name is Brittany Davis. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm coming to you from Harlem in New York. I'm the Associate Director of Community Accountability and Engagement at the Center for Court Innovation, and we're so glad to be in partnership with Youth Collaboratory on this project and to be with all of you today. I'm just looking at the participant list, which is growing and growing, and just so excited that so many of you all were interested in participating in this today. And so just want to share a little bit about the Center for Court Innovation. We are a nonprofit based in New York City, and our mission is to work to achieve justice and equity, create safe, healthy, and thriving communities, and ultimately transform the justice system. We have three major areas of our work. We have research, where our research teams perform original research on a variety of topics and provide data analytics on our projects. We did some research back in the mid-2000s on understanding issues related to youth experiencing trafficking in several cities. We also have our operating programs, which is essentially the direct service arm of our organization, where we implement court and community justice programs. An example of this would be our Bronx Community Solutions, where we have been one of the service providers of the Human Trafficking Intervention Court part in New York City. And we are currently working to build out our survivor leadership programming through an initiative called Project Heal, which is also funded by OVC. And finally, we provide researchers or reformers, across the world with expert assistance that they need to launch their own new strategies. And we've been in the trafficking space for many years right now. And we've worked with many jurisdictions as they've been enhancing their human trafficking legal response systems. And it really is just the interaction and interdependence of these three pillars, which is the foundation of all that we do. So I work particularly on our gender and family justice team, which is a small but mighty team of about 12 individuals where we provide training and technical assistance on a variety of gender-based violence related issues, including domestic violence, sexual assault, stalking, dating violence, and human trafficking. We take a really values-driven approach to our work, and the values on this slide guide our efforts. When we are doing technical assistance, we make sure that we are responsive, understanding that every community is different. We believe really in customizing our work to suit the resources and goals of your jurisdiction. We also are reflective, believing in analyzing challenges and solutions from multiple angles and noticing and recognizing that our work requires in-depth reflections by systems on their impact and the communities that we serve. We echo Youth Collaboratory's excitement for our speakers. We are just so fortunate and so lucky that we have an all-star group of facilitators and presenters who are going to speak with you about their amazing work across the country. The panelists will discuss key principles such as the importance of judicial leadership, effective strategies for multidisciplinary collaboration and strategic partnerships, tips on providing trauma-informed support to survivors navigating the juvenile legal system, and culturally responsive and restorative approaches that center Black girls and their leadership. So we'll be hearing from Judge Stacey Bulwer-Urey, Dominic McNally. Ms. Pink was unfortunately unable to attend today, but she is a part of the Queens Community Justice Center. We'll also be hearing from Kenesha Warren and Wakumi Douglas from Soul Sisters Leadership Collective. So just in the form of an agenda for our participants today, each panelist will speak for about 20 to 25 minutes, and there will be a dedicated time for questions and answers at the end of the presentation. But everyone, feel free to post your questions in the chat. We will take note of them and make sure that we are getting those answers for you at the end of the presentation. So feel free to make use of the chat. And with that, I'd love to introduce our first presenter, and I'm going to read briefly her bio. Judge Stacey Bulwer-Urey was appointed to the Superior Court of California in June 2007. As the presiding juvenile court judge from 2010 to 2018, she worked with youth and families appearing in both juvenile justice and child welfare cases to protect the child and the public, to preserve and strengthen children's families. Judge Bulwer-Uri has also been an active member of the California legal community for over 20 years. She implemented a nationally recognized trauma-informed and multidisciplinary court docket for young survivors of sex trafficking and consulted with many jurisdictions on how courts can improve their effectiveness in overseeing, serving, and supporting this unique population. So with that, I am going to turn it over to Judge Bulwer-Uri.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much, Brittany. In the next 20 minutes, I hope to share as much as I can with you. You have my contact information in the slides. So if I don't get to a question, I will try and answer it should you choose to email me. Again, good morning to everyone. So as I go through the conversation this morning in my presentation, I want to make sure that I am acknowledging that no judicial officer does this work alone. So my perspective is really a perspective that's informed not just by my role as a judicial officer, but all that I have learned from and with and standing alongside our thrivers and survivors. This first slide sort of shows to you the construct of our multidisciplinary dedicated court. And I think it goes without mentioning, although I will mention it as well, the youth is the center. The youth is the key stakeholder. There is nothing for youth without them. So as we went through building our court, we were really led by survivors both in the Sacramento area as well as around California. The other partners, again, are necessary in our perspective because no system, no judicial officer is able to achieve a true service and support and helping to ensure that youth have appropriate connections to the community without the community being with us and going through the process. As mentioned at the outset, I really want to acknowledge and lift up that yes, boys and girls are exploited, but our work was focused and centered on youth of color and particularly Black girls because they are so disproportionately impacted. Our juvenile justice calendar is just that. It was a juvenile justice calendar that otherwise went through the normal procedures of a juvenile justice case, but we peeled back the onion. I looked behind the charge to see what was going on, to figure out how and why youth who were being impacted by exploitation were arriving in our courtroom. So as noted before, really trying to center our work not only with youth and survivor voice, but understanding what we could and what we needed to know in terms of trauma. Because again, this work really is about the youth and helping them navigate through systems that are in and of themselves at times very confusing. Through the collaboration, again, really focused on the best interest of the youth, balanced with holding them accountable for their behavior, specialized treatment services, and frequent judicial monitoring. One of the slides you see right there is consistent courtroom personnel. For us, it was really important not just they have a dedicated judge who knew them and they began to know, that they didn't have to retell their story if they chose to a different judicial officer every time. But it's also important in our perspective that we had the same clerk, we had the same bailiff, we had the same court liaison, either for probation or child welfare, in addition to having the same dedicated attorneys who were present. It was important for us from a consistency and stability standpoint that we had these same faces and same members, not just for the youth, but so that we could all grow together. We did sharing and learning together. It wasn't just as a judge, I went and did some education and some training and came back. We all learned in the same space at the same time so that we were able to interact and ask questions based on our own individual and separate legal and ethical obligations, not just about exploitation, but also about trauma. So for example, my bailiff would know that if a young person was coming in and they seemed to be struggling in some sense, that it wasn't the normal hat that they would wear, that there's a different sense of understanding and empathy, again, because they had different dedicated training as it related to trauma, as well as to sexual exploitation. The notion of the dedicated calendar for these types of cases, really we had everything from petty theft to armed robbery. We had everything from drug use and abuse to other type of property crimes and personal assault offenses. So we really had every type of offense that was coming through. But again, in peeling back that onion and looking behind the charge, having a humility and understanding that we were just seeing some behaviors that were on the top of the ocean, that we knew there was so much more underneath that led to this youth coming in contact with the system. It helped to ground us. It helped us to be humble in understanding and being curious as to what it was in this youth's life that was bringing them before the court. So as we move through, one of the things that we really, again, wanted to highlight and lift up is that the trauma can impact all aspects of behavior, decision-making, communication, and focus. Really understanding that the behavioral responses in a courtroom oftentimes weren't a function of what was going on in the courtroom, but what had this child had experienced that, again, brought them in and what they were navigating throughout their lives within the community. Wanted to acknowledge that minimization of behaviors or experiences, memory loss, lack of ability to focus, particularly if you're hearing from schools, those were types of symptoms that were manifesting from their trauma, and really trying to understand from the outset of the case how important it was to have a sense of what this youth had experienced. For us, the system, our procedures started with utilizing the West Coast Children's Clinic CSEC tool to understand the trauma that they had experienced and how we were going to need to factor that in to our services and supports. We know from adolescent brain development that just in general, adolescents are less able to control their impulses or resist triggers. And when you layer the experience of exploitation on that, it's far more difficult for them at times to engage in a way that adults think they should be engaging. So again, really trying to ground our understanding of the court process through their eyes, through their lens, and what it is that they needed to know. I also wanna make sure that I'm lifting up and highlighting for our dedicated calendar, all of our youth had experienced exploitation or were at high risk of exploitation. However, the exploitation was never the focus of our proceedings. It was only if the youth chose to and wanted to discuss or reference that exploitation that it was ever brought up. So for us, it was really important to understand, not that we were quote unquote ignoring the obvious, but that wasn't the center of how we were engaging with that youth. So I also want to make sure that we understand that that was something that we all knew was present. It wasn't something that was the centerpiece of how we were going to serve and support that youth. From a judicial perspective, again, what's wrong with you to what has happened to you? I think too often adults and sometimes my brethren have this focus like, what's wrong with you? Why are you doing this? Without really, again, taking a literal pause and understanding what has happened to you, what has brought you here. I think it's really important for judicial officers to be upfront and to be real. These youth have experienced all sorts of things and they read us pretty well. They know when someone's being genuine, they know when someone's not. And it's important from our perspective, again, to be impeccable with your words, to be consistent and transparent, to speak with them in a language that they understand, not patronizing, not speaking down to them, but using and mirroring language where we can and when it is appropriate. For each hearing, for the first time a youth came before me, I explained to them, hey, I have this file of materials. We're gonna get to all this legal stuff later. But I want to know from you, youth, how you see yourself. So I would ask every youth to give me three adjectives that they chose in terms of how they see themselves. And it was something that I would reference throughout the life of the case to try and reinforce sort of that positive reinforcement of things that they were able to see in themselves, but sometimes either the system and or the charges didn't reflect. also think it was really important to explain to my youth that this was their hearing and they get the last word. We handle our business, the attorneys make the arguments that they need to make, the court makes its orders. And before we close out every hearing, I would turn to the youth and they got to share whatever it is they wanted to share. Either they had questions or they wanted to share something positive that had nothing to do with the court proceeding, or they were mad and wanted to discuss something, either the attorney or maybe even an order I made, but really trying to give the youth an opportunity to own the present and have their own agency through this very confusing court system we found was very important to give them that voice in a way that was appropriate. Again, be impeccable with your words, expect testing, understand that when we're talking about the tip of the iceberg, we're never going to know everything that has happened. We know we're never going to know their full story and probably never will. And in some cases, we don't need to. But again, acknowledging that there is a story and that they get to tell it in their terms on their own time. Celebrating small successes. Sometimes it is, hey, judge, I went to school 2 days this week. Okay. So again, the normal thing would be, why aren't you in school 5 days a week? There may be lots of reasons why they're not in school, but giving them that space and looking for those opportunities to celebrate small successes. Again, a function of positive reinforcement. These youth are navigating so much. And as we know from the stages of change, they're going to go through different phases in terms of how they understand what's happening to them. And something that might be very small to us is really important to them. So really looking for and seeking out those small successes to celebrate, we think is really appropriate. Measurements. So what is success? I would also say that whether you have a dedicated calendar or not, success is an individualized issue. A success for one child may be to be weaned off of heroin. For another child, it may be the ability to go to school and stay in school. For another child who might be in placement, it means that they are feeling safe and connected, and either they aren't leaving or they're leaving for shorter periods of time. So when we're looking for those successes, we really want to look at, is it stability in placement? Are there longer periods between the time of absconding? Are they engaged in TFCBT? One of the things that we think is really appropriate is understanding that therapy piece, understanding the trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy. In our courtroom, our clinicians are present during the proceedings for a couple of different reasons. First is to give that youth the sense and physical sense of quote unquote safety with someone that they know is just there for them. But we would also have those spaces in between a calendar where we're waiting for the next youth to come in, where in real time, our dedicated clinicians can say, hey judge, or hey DA, or hey county council, this is what I'm seeing. Or I can ask them, how did you think that went? Is there something that you would share with the court to do differently or to repeat? So really understanding that the support that youth have can also be support that, if we're humble enough to ask, can give to those system partners in a way to improve experiences and to do a better job. For some youth, age-appropriate success can be reunification with family when it's safe to do so. And again, meeting educational and or employment goals, depending on that youth. Judges can. So I'm a very big advocate of the opportunity that judicial officers have to be leaders. Young people who are experiencing trafficking are navigating complex, multidimensional systems, which require multi-system engagement. And as I said at the outset, we don't do this alone. I can make all of the orders in the world that I want to, but unless the youth has connections in their own space and community to succeed, then it's just a function of me making orders. So again, really want to encourage judicial officers to get off of the bench and into the community, understanding that we can convene a lot of meetings, but it's also important, and I think a measure of genuine humility, go meet them where they're at. We hold meetings. I hold a ton of meetings with educators. and I go to the school. If I want to go and meet with community supporters who have a drop-in center, I'm going to go to the drop-in center. Sure, they can come to the courthouse and there's all of that structure and impact, but I also think it's a good measure of partnership for the judges to literally get off of the bench, go to our community where the community is. Reaching out to your communities, again, to learn about what's available. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. We also don't have to think that we know it all. So yes, as you said in the chat, courthouses can be intimidating. So getting your community together in a way that we're going to the community, I think is important. You want to establish accountability measures. Again, not losing sight that these are juvenile justice proceedings. So we do have a youth who has allegedly committed a crime. And for that, there are normal things that a court is obligated to do in terms of accountability. But accountability is different for every child. Every youth is an individual with individual experiences and are deserving of individually tailored orders. So your accountability measures aren't a one size fit all. And particularly for youth who have experienced exploitation, you need to know that that's also important to consider. I'm going to speed it up real quick because I know I only have about 3 minutes left. Not all treatment is equal. Again, you want to ensure you're not just making a one size fits all set of orders across the board, no matter what the offense is. Want to make sure that you are tailoring the experience. Again, as noted, we'll have a therapist present in the courtroom for the youth to feel safe. And I want to just pause here for a second. A couple of times you've seen me put air quotes around safe. What I think is safe is determined by the fact that I'm a 51-year-old woman who has a professional degree and a stable job. What the youth think is safe is different. So I also ask the youth for them to define for us how they view safety and how or why they feel safe in different spaces. And whether we agree or not, it's giving us insight into how that youth is determining for themselves what safety is. We know that there are clearly circumstances that are physically not safe for them, but if we have that understanding from them in their own words, then we're able to shape and shift how we serve and support that youth to meet them where they're at and where they would like to go for themselves. And again, it gives us an opportunity to empower them through their own choices. Judges can educate youth as much as they can, as we should, about the process. It's intimidating, it's confusing, but unfortunately for some youth, it's also something that can be fairly familiar, particularly if you are in a child welfare or dependency context. Your judge could be the most consistent person in your life. And I'll leave the commentary, but needing to understand that we are explaining to them what's going on and how we are reaching decisions and giving them a voice where it is appropriate to do so, I think makes the process less confusing. Special attention needs to be placed on caregivers, whether that's mom, dad, grandma, auntie, non-related extended family member. They too are probably experiencing lots of confusion and fear on behalf of the child that they are providing care for. So looking for opportunities within the community to tailor services and support for the caregiver also helps to provide greater stability for the youth. I know that can be hard in some jurisdictions, but I think it's a really important piece. We don't want to forget the moms, the dads, the caregivers, the aunties, who are providing the support. So lots of different ways that we can serve and support exploited youth and boys and girls, particularly girls of color. I know I have about 1 minute left. So Brittany, I am going to stop and pause, but again, just really want to reemphasize nothing for them without them. You have to do this alongside and be informed and educated by survivors. There are amazing women out there who have navigated and are thriving in their lives and can share with us how to make our systems better. There are ways that we can learn from one another, and we have to be able to be humble enough to know that every day there is something to learn. For the panelists on here this morning, I told them I'm so excited to be here today, not just to share with the audience, but to learn from them. So I want to thank you all for your service, your support, and your partnership. in empowering our youth. Ms. Brittany.
Thank you so much, Judge. That was amazing. Just so many things. The whole entire presentation is resonating with me, but it was something that I keep kind of mulling over my brain right now is just some of the things that you're saying about getting off of the bench and into the community. Someone had talked about how sometimes the court experience can be intimidating, but when we have people going out to the community, learning from each other, building connections and building rapport, all of that can take some of that intimidating nature away. And the other point that I loved was how you called youth stakeholders. I think sometimes we forget that and think of the judge and the prosecutor and the teacher and all of the people but the youth. But as you said at the end, nothing for them without them. So I really love all of the things that you were talking about, having them define safety, asking them what their needs are, where they want to go, and trying to meet them where they're at. So as we transition to the next wonderful panelist, we'd love for folks just to drop in the chat any of the things that you were taking away from that presentation, and we'll read some of those out. And as you all are engaging in the chat in that way, I will just introduce our next speakers who hail from New York City. They are my colleagues, and I'm so excited that they are going to be presenting with you all today. I'd love to welcome Dominique McNally and Kanesha Warren. They run Queen's Hope, which provides specialized direct support and mentoring services to young people who are survivors of or at risk of sex trafficking. Dominique McNally is a clinical coordinator at the Queens Community Justice Center, which she joined in February of 2020. She came to QCJC from Washington, DC, where she provided crisis intervention to decrease out-of-home placement for at-risk youth. Ms. McNally has a background working in the Juvenile Specialty Court in DC, which involved youth with behavioral and mental health concerns, as well as youth who have experienced trafficking. And Kanesha Warren joined the Queens Community Justice Center in July 2018, where she worked as a parent coach, providing support to parents whose children were court involved. In February 2020, she transitioned to her current role as a case manager and mentor for the Queens Hope Program. She provides support and resources for young people and is very passionate in supporting and educating youth on their self-worth. So I'm just going to check the chat really quickly and see what folks are saying. I see from Lawrence that from the judge's presentation, there was the reminder that it's important to teach them how to exercise their agency. Other folks were talking about gaining some new language and terminology. Bethany talked about loving hearing youth as stakeholders. That was something that's stood out to me as well. And Benita just dropped two wonderful resources into the chat that you all should definitely take a look at. So thank you so much, Judge. And I'm going to pass it over to our wonderful presenters from Queens.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you, Brittany. As Brittany stated, my name is Dominique McNally, and I'm the clinical coordinator at the Queens Community Justice Center. The Queens Community Justice Center is a project for the Center for Court Innovation, was established in 2007 as the alternative to detention provider in Queens. Since 2007, we have grown to include alternatives to incarceration programs in criminal court, mentoring services, reentry and aftercare services, clinical initiatives, workforce development programs, and gender-specific programming. As a provider for alternative to detention programming, the family court mandates young people ages 12 to 17 years old with open delinquency cases to us for community supervision and monitoring. We started to notice that our current programming was not working for many of the girls who were mandated to our services. The young women were initially engaged in attending programming and then would lose contact with them. The patterns that we were seeing were young people would leave home frequently for long periods of time. They might report to us that they have significantly older partners or spend a lot of time with older persons, frequent truancy. They were also involved with multiple systems such as juvenile justice and child welfare. Some of the arrests that we were seeing were petty larceny, assault, and status offenses like truancy and running away. We began to realize that many of our girls were victims and survivors of sex trafficking or were at high risk. They were being arrested for behaviors directly related to their exploitation and or strategies they were using for survival were being criminalized. With a grant from the OJJDP, we were able to develop and run a specialized direct support and mentoring program to support victims and survivors of human trafficking and work with the court stakeholders to identify and divert young people from the system. When creating the program, we needed to focus on making sure we were highlighted being survivor-centered, trauma-informed, strength-based, developmentally appropriate, culturally and linguistically responsive, LGBTQIA-affirming, centered on youth engagement, multidisciplinary, individualized, flexible, and timely, and data and outcome-driven. Queens Hope is geared towards female and female-identified youth from ages 12 to 18 years old who are exhibiting at-risk behaviors in the community. Behaviors at risk in the community. The term at risk is an umbrella term, so some of the behaviors would include absconding from the home for periods of time, ACS involvement, foster care involvement, court involvement, truancy, and that's just to name a few. Queens Hope provides a variety of services, such as one-to-one counseling, where we address some of the trauma that the youth express, provide psychoeducation around diagnosis, medication management, and address grief and loss with family dynamics. We also provide mentoring case management services, which assist in providing resources such as mommy-to-be programs, GED programs, or employment services. The youth are also assigned a mentor to assist and guide them through their certain day-to-day struggles where they don't feel comfortable discussing it with parents or guardians in the home. We also have two groups which are held at the center. One is a survivors-led My Life, My Choice, which is a TED Week-led survivor curriculum. Our others is a youth-led program where the youth provide topics and the staff provide education and support to address the concerns of the individual. At Queens Hope, we always provide safety planning, assist young people in identifying a positive support system, trauma-informed wraparound intensive case management, access to high-quality mentoring and supportive services. And also, while engaged in services, we order food for the youth and provide them with Metro cards to ensure they're able to travel back home safely. On site, we also have access to a shower, feminine hygiene products, and clothing available for youth who need it. Queens Hope focuses on our trauma-informed approach. We provide a safe space physically and mentally, making the youth feel comfortable by displaying positive affirmations and providing photos that look like them, a calming atmosphere. Also, we inform them of our confidentiality, letting them know that not everything discussed in sessions or in group is shared with judges, parents, probation, and their attorneys. We also strive for survivor-centered practices, which allows youth to be the expert in their own journey. We allow the youth to lead us into the healing that they want. We allow the youth to let us know what their charges are, what they're referred for, until they feel comfortable. For an example, originally I had a youth who was engaged with our services, and she expressed that she did not feel comfortable coming to the center. And then she also discussed that she did not feel comfortable being on screen. After a few telehealth sessions, the youth asked me to come to meet her at her school. So I went over to meet her at her school. We had a session, and after the session, she expressed that she wanted to come tour the facility to see if she would be able to engage in services in person, but she only wanted to come by if nobody else was there. So at that time, we went over, took an Uber to our center. I gave her a tour of the facility. We had our session and we had lunch. And now she's actually requesting to be able to come in person for our sessions for group. We also build trust. We build trust, respect, choice, and rapport. By being transparent with the youth, not hiding information, and not talking down to them, and allowing them to feel heard without any judgment. We also come from a strength-based approach. Majority of the youth express that they've been in the system and they come in contact with different entities where they felt that there were trouble and that there were always going to be trouble. We at Queens Hope and staff provide them the skills and acknowledge their strength and build on it. Empower and collaborate with our youth. We promote self-advocacy and encourage them to use their words and develop peer support and give them a different perspective about adults and services. We partner with collaterals. We take a teaming approach to reach out to our referral source and other agencies involved to be able to advocate for our youth, but also educate the entities about utilizing trauma-informed approaches. Also, if any of our youth are in abscondance, we strive to maintain communication with their parents so that once the youth returns, we can pick up from services immediately. Our mentoring practices, we provide connection between mentor and youth to offer guidance, support, and care. It takes time to develop relationships and build trust with our youth. We engage youth in meaningful conversations, create positive role models for the young people, and provide pathways for youth towards behavioral, academic, and social well-being. At this time, I'm gonna revert it over to our case manager and mentor, Kanasia Warren.
Hi everyone, my name is Kanasia Warren. I'm a mentor and a case manager for my queens. Throughout my talk, you're gonna hear me say queen a lot because that's why I consider my girls, they are my queens, they are my everything. First thing I do is I build a relationship with them. After I build a relationship with them, I let them know that whatever we talk about and whatever we go through is between me and them. A lot of times my queens, they find me to be their best friend. They find me to be the other mother. They find me to be the home girl because I meet them where they at. If they come in and they have an attitude, it's okay. I know today is a bad day for you. Can we talk about it? If they say no, it's okay. Maybe later on while we walking around or we talking, you want to express yourself. While I'm mentoring, I notice that my girls have low self-esteem. A lot of them African-Americans, they have low self-esteem. They don't like their look. They don't like their nose. They don't even like their hair. So what I do is that I ask them to write down the things that they would like to change about themselves, and then we work on it. Once they indicate to me that they want to change their nose, they want to change their hair, they want to change their body shape due to social media and the things that they say, I always let my queens know that you are beautiful in every way. I always give them compliments. I always see them when they have something new. I give them the biggest compliment, like, oh my God, you is fly today, girl. We always go through if I could, if I would sections. That's the one-on-ones that we go through. And as what I notice is that a lot of time when I have one of my queens, and at the beginning, they say, I wish I could be a different person. By the time we finish a 6 weeks or a 4 week section, they be like, Miss Kanasia, I love the way I look. I am fly, right? And that's what they need. They need to know that they are very important. They are beautiful and nothing out there in the world that they cannot do. As I'm mentoring, I notice that the parents are calling me and they saying, Miss Kanasia, I notice that my child have a different outlook about life. I noticed that my child, they don't, you know, cut school as much. They're coming home, they're doing chores. And when you hear things like that as a mentor, it's so uplifting. It's like, I just won a lottery because it's letting me know that my job that I'm doing is not in vain. While I'm mentoring the young ladies and they have significant others or they maybe have boyfriends that seem to be a little older than them, I try to encourage them to let them know that, you know, you don't have to depend on people to get things. What we can do is that I meet them where they at and I ask them, what you like to do? Do you like to do hair? Do you like to do nails? And they say, yes, yes, yes. So myself and Dominique, we get together and we try to have hairstyling classes, nail classes. We have to have makeup classes. We teach them how to do eyelashes because dealing with the youth these days, they're looking at TikTok. They're looking at Instagram, they on Facebook, and they looking at these girls and they like, oh, they so beautiful, why can't be that beautiful? That's when they try to do things to get that beautiful. But me and Dominique, what we do is that we let them know that if you use your skills that you have, it's everything is impossible. So we teach them how to do, to make wigs. A lot of African-American young ladies, they love wigs, they love weaves. So we teach them how to do it. We teach them how to braid. We teach them how to do the nails, the cosmetology, and it helps them. And they into it and they love it. And they just come back and they talk about it. And then and actually they tell their friends and they tell their classmates. So we get phone calls, we get all type of things. And the mothers are saying, oh, I love the way that y'all interact with my child. For example, I had a young lady to call me up 2 days ago, and she said, Miss Kanasia, you know, I just had a baby, because we have young ladies that have a baby. And she said, I feel so ugly right now. Like, I do not feel pretty. I explained to her that she's going through postpartum depression right now, and that she, her body is going to get the way it used to be. But what she has to do right now is concentrate on Joy. That's her baby name. And just look at Joy and be like, Joy, you're going to be so amazing when you get older. And then I told her to go in the room if she need a moment to herself, to tell herself that I'm beautiful. I'm just going through this now, but I am beautiful. And one thing I always tell my queens is that y'all have a crown, and please don't tilt your crown. If they come in one day and they come in moping or with a little down, I always say, queen, tilt your crown, straighten it up. Your crown is tilting. And they love that. So now that we have our one-on-one talks, they go, Miss Kanasia, I tilt my crown today. I'm like, okay, no problem. And that's one thing that we need to do. We need to encourage especially the African-American young ladies and let them know that you are beautiful. I mean, it's nothing you cannot do. If the sky's the limit, go to that limit. And I just love it. I just love my job. And I love that I have the opportunity to meet them where they at, to talk to them where they at. And I always inform them that when we talk, we talk. We talk about everything. And I really appreciate it. I'm going to pass it back over to Dominique McNally.
Thank you so much, Kanasia. And just following up from what Kanasia said, the lessons that we learned from everything that she discussed was that we have to lead by youth interest guides programming. We held a soap workshop where the girls were able to create their own soap and learn how to utilize their creative gifts and make it profitable. Another highlight was participants were able to observe healthy relationship dynamics within our female and male staff. We also provided trainings and leadership skills so that the youth were able to lead a social media campaign and educate their peers in the community about IPV and DV, where they were able to receive stipends. Some of the youth in the project were directly impacted, witnessed, or know someone who has been affected. As Kanasia discussed, some of our self-care events centered around youth taking care of themselves. During the pandemic, we realized that the youth were expressing frustration around being home, dealing with COVID mandates, and struggling with school and family issues. We created a self-care brunch to allow them to go outside while still being COVID compliant, to express themselves, learn about self-care, and utilize the different coping skills that we learned. Upon launching the program, we had the opportunity to meet with delinquency judges and prosecutors by inviting them to our facility and giving them a tour. The aim was to allow them to meet with the staff who would directly be providing services to the youth. Through this experience, it ensured that the judges and prosecutors could be confident in knowing the youth were being referred to appropriate services. Also, we had the specialized trafficking unit in the DA's office offered to provide support by coming in to speak with the youth to develop trust between the DA and the community. Also, having staff in the courtrooms help build rapport with court officials to help referrals for the appropriate services. We also offer training, support stakeholders and community providers to educate them about the local services that we have, and also to inform about trauma-informed care, red flags, and how we could provide solutions together. Also, meeting with our referral sources on a regular basis to remind them of the services offered. Reach out once a month, let them know you're still accepting referrals, let them know the different upcoming events that you guys are holding. Invite stakeholders to events at the Justice Center. Once a year, the Queens Community Justice Center has Spirit Week, where each day is dedicated to certain topics. So for instance, we have health and wellness, we have community service day, we have arts and media day, we have job development day. And lastly, our Friday that we close out is like a community block party where the community stakeholders, community partners, community members, and we all together have fellowship with fun, food, and creative activities. Also, we also reach out to different partners within the community and table at their events and provide information about our programming and our referrals just to see how we can connect and partner to provide different services together in the community. Lastly, our outcomes. So far at this time, no participants have been rearrested during their time in the program. 82% of the young people have experienced positive behavioral changes in their family relationship. 88% have experienced positive behavioral change in their social competence, and 95% have experienced positive behavioral change in pro-social behavior. And 92% have experienced positive perception of their peer support. All of these outcomes have come from self-reporting from the youth, reporting from other entities within the court, whether it's during a court hearing, whether it's from Department of Probation, and whether it's from the parents within the home. As Ms. Warren stated earlier, us receiving information and feedback from the parents of how their youth has shown drastic differences from the time they started the program, from the time that they finished. And also from within the staff, we're able to see and hear our participants explain to us that how they would have handled the situation 2 months ago is how they handled it now. Now, it's probably not in the best way, but instead of going straight to physical, they might have just had an argument and was able to walk away. So those are the small wins that we look at and the small changes that we strive for to see in our participants. I want to thank you guys for hearing this out and acknowledging Queen's Hope.
Thank you so much, Dominique and Kinesia. I could just feel the love that you have for the participants in your presentation. I just thank you for all of the really amazing work that you all are doing out there in Queens for your Queens. I would love for folks also just to drop any takeaways. I saw some things in the chat already, but as I introduce our next speaker, would love for folks just to share just some tidbits that you might take back to your own communities as you continue in this work. And in the meantime, I will share the bio of our final presenter, which is Tanisha Wakumi Douglas. As a daughter of an undocumented immigrant who served 33 years in prison, Ms. Douglas has dedicated her life to building leadership among youth most impacted by mass incarceration and other oppressive systems. Wakumi is the founding executive director of Soul Sisters Leadership Collective, which builds leadership with systems-involved girls and transgender nonconforming youth in both Miami and New York City. She is currently on an 18-month writing sabbatical from that role, pursuing a Soros Justice Fellowship. She has worked as a restorative justice circle keeper, social worker, community organizer, trainer, and popular educator. She was a 2018 Move to End Violence Fellow and is a 2020 Soros Justice Fellow. Wakumi is featured in Dr. Monique Morris's 2019 documentary Push Out, The Criminalization of Black Girls in Schools, as a pioneer on the subject. And her work has been featured in the Huffington Post, NPR, and Miami New Times. And her books include Sing a Rhythm, Dance a Blues by Morris, and Making Change by Cruz. She has spoken on stages at Google, and the National Educators Association has shared the stage with the Dr. Angela Davis, Erica Huggins, and Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley. So I'm going to read through some of the things in the chat. Let's see. I saw Christopher saying that he would love Kinesia to be a mentor for him. I'm seeing just loving how you brought your full authentic selves into the presentation. Bobby shared speaking life into the girls about how they are all beautiful just as they are and to resist the pressure of advertising and social media influence on beauty. All of that is really wonderful. Sunshine says, I love how you connect with the queens. It may be the first time they are actually listened to and given special attention. So thank you all again for that amazing work. And with that, I'm going to transition to Wakumi.
Awesome. It's great to be with everyone. And thank you so much to the previous speakers. As the judge said, I am learning so much and I'm so energized by the work. So for my presentation, I want to say a couple of things before we dive in. The first is my presentation is going to be extremely narrative focused. I'm going to be sharing stories. For those of you who are really interested in outcomes and numbers and want to see the impact of the work that Soul Sisters has done, I would direct you to our website where we have our 5-year impact report that really details all the outcomes of our work. And that link was just dropped in the chat. The second thing I want to say before we dive in is that Soul Sisters is not an organization specifically focused on CSEC. And so I wanna honor and acknowledge the extremely nuanced and powerful work of organizations specifically and courtrooms and other entities specifically focused on CSEC. Soul Sisters is an organization that interacts with young people who are at risk of CSEC and have sometimes been involved in CSEC, but we're not specifically focused on that, which is exciting in a presentation like this because it gives us an opportunity to focus on what organizations like ours, but like there may be many of you on this webinar who can relate, our organizations aren't specifically focused on CSEC, but we wanna make sure we're creating safety for young people who are at risk. And so what I'm gonna be sharing are some of the strategies that we use within our organization that we believe promote that safety. Okay. All right. Okay. So my bio was already shared, but I like to also share that as my bio stated, I am a person who's directly impacted by the legal system, having spent 33 years on the outside with my father who was incarcerated, having been arrested myself. I'm also a survivor of violence. I think this is important because as folks have shared on the call, it's really important that directly impacted people be the ones that are leading the work because we're the ones with the lived experience that know how to design the types of interventions that are needed for the lasting changes that we need in our systems. And there are some other things here on this slide about me. All right, so Soul Sisters Leadership Collective was founded in 2014 in both New York City and in Miami. And I wanna share that it's important to share that Soul Sisters was founded in deep collaboration with young people who are directly impacted. Actually, prior to 2014, when I was working at another large nonprofit organization running into an alternative to incarceration program, Soul Sisters was launched as a small project of that large nonprofit. We received some training from a local organization on young women's leadership approach. And we went to that training, the staff, myself, two other staff members, and three directly impacted young people who were court involved. And after having received that training on building young women's leadership, the young people, we did that training for 5 days. The young people said, oh, we know what we want to call our program. At the time, I was going by Tanisha. Miss Tanisha, we know what we want to call our program. And we said, what do you want to call the program? And they said, it has to be Soul Sisters Leadership. It has to be that. So the actual name of the organization our organization was named by directly impacted young people. That's really important. So when we talk about centering young people, Soul Sisters narrative begins and ends with youth. So that's critical. When we launched from a small program to a larger nonprofit entity, an independent nonprofit entity in 2014, we did that again with young people. So it was with young people that we decided to become a collective. It was with young people that we wrote the words that you see here on the slides that are our mission and vision statements. This, all of this language, all of our purpose, it comes from youth. Okay, so I wanna make sure I'm on the right track here. My notes, good. So Soul Sisters has 8 grounding principles. I'm gonna read them out loud that ground our work. Sankofa, which is an Akan word from the territory known as Ghana. That means our past informs our future. Collectivism and interconnectedness, meaning we are more powerful together. Emotional justice, that everyone has the right to heal. Hope and transformation, that change, we believe that change is possible. That part's really important, especially for young people who have been through what so many of our young people have been through. We believe that change is possible. Spirituality, that we're all connected to something greater than ourselves. I think sometimes in our work, we are sometimes afraid to engage spirituality. We don't want to offend. So within our work at Soul Sisters, we don't promote any one particular religious tradition. we invite and welcome folks to bring their whole selves, including our spiritual selves. That's a part of who we are. Personal agency, that individuals have the power to control their circumstances. Cultural awareness, this part's really important and is going to, I'm going to talk about in more detail, that deep knowledge of our culture supports our growth and healing. That's really important. So in our work at Soul Sisters, we celebrate young people's culture, similar to what folks from Queen's Hope were talking about. The young people twerk in the program, the young people play their music in the program. We celebrate the young people's culture now, the contemporary culture. And we also expose young people to African cultures, to indigenous cultural traditions that they may not have been aware of, but that are at the root of a lot of these cultures. For our young, we practice in our program something called libations. And so folks may be familiar with this in hip hop culture where folks pour one out for the homies, right? For people who have passed on, but that comes from ancient African traditions. And so we teach that to our young people, that actually pour one out for the homies, that's something called libations from ancient West African traditions. And so it's important that young people understand that our culture is grounded in something with a strong, deep, powerful, and long, long legacy. That's important. And then lastly, creativity, that the arts are powerful, and we do a lot of artistic work in our programs. Okay, it's our foundational belief at Soul Sisters that in order to dismantle identity-based oppression and economic exploitation, we must center the leadership of girls and non-binary youth of color and honor the historical legacy of girls, women, and non-binary folks of color in securing many of the rights we enjoy today. That statement is a central statement in terms of what we believe at Soul Sisters. Soul Sisters' approach is on multiple levels. We're absolutely concerned with young people at the individual level. We're concerned with community at the meso level and programs, and we're also concerned with structures. So Soul Sisters is an organization that's seeking to intervene at all of those levels. Okay, we've got lots of programs. I'm not going to describe all of them because I do not have enough time. And our website is really descriptive. And so I would encourage folks to go to our website, but we have a Youth Leaders Board program, which is our youth, our peer leader program for young people who are trained to do trainings and facilitate and work with other young people. They intern, they speak at conferences, they help design programs. That's one of our programs. Sisterhood Academy is our program where we go into facilities and do leadership workshops. That's actually how we're known to Queens Youth Justice Center, through Sisterhood Academy. We have a Fashion for Social Change program, which is an exciting, really cool social entrepreneurship program. We do a lot of social action and community here in Miami. We are the conveners of a coalition called the Black Girls Matter Coalition. We go to Tallahassee every year and turn up on the legislators and advocate for bills and take up space in the halls of power and do lots of other work in the streets. We organize marches, we organize rallies, we do all that work. Heart and Soul is our emotional and healing justice program where young people work individually with freedom coaches, with passionate freedom coaches like Ms. Kanesha. Ooh, I hope I said your name right. And then also do group work and other kinds of, are able to access therapists, are able to access crisis intervention, et cetera, through Heart and Soul. And then we have quite a number of restorative programs. All right, Soul Sisters core methodology. So our core methodology is, one, we're trauma-informed and healing engaged. Two, at the center of our core of our work are restorative and transformative justice interventions. I'm gonna talk about that in more detail because it's so central to what we do. Popular education is really important for us. So popular education is a concept that was coined by a theorist in Brazil named Paulo Freire, whose essential thesis is that in order for folks who are experiencing oppression to receive education that's valuable to us, that education needs to be relevant, that education needs to be focused on action and transformation, that he also tells us that education is not neutral, right? So those folks who are following what's happening across the country right now with state legislators trying to erase the education around racism and LGBT issues, that's happening in Florida right now, where they're trying to ban schools from teaching about race and LGBT issues, yeah? Education is not neutral, right? Meaning that how we educate people has the ability to support us in getting the social justice that we need or not. And so this is the way that Soul Sisters This is how we design our educational workshops using these ideas and this methodology. There's so much more to say about it, but I'm really aware of time. And then lastly, we are serious about cultural celebration and responsiveness, like I named. We do chants, we sing songs, we pour libations, we paint, we engage young people in plant-based medicines. Oh my gosh, the young people love it when we whip out the lavender oil and the sage, and we're teaching them about how they can use plants, use the wisdom of Mother Earth to support their healing and well-being. All right, our work is deeply, deeply healing centered. What does that mean? One is we invite young people to share about things that they've gone through, if and when they feel ready. What I will say though in our work is as soon as we sit young people in circle and we share our circle practices and we start passing the talking piece, young people are ready to go. What young people have been through, it's what we experience is on the surface. It's right on their chest. And when given an opportunity to share in a brave space, what we find is young people are willing to share. We support young people in drafting their own narratives. So we did a summer program in 2020 virtually where we had a leadership seminar, and a part of the leadership seminar was young people drafting their own social biography narrative. And in that narrative, we invite young people to share some things that they've been through, and also to share how the things that they've been through have essentially made them strong. How has it built their resilience? How has it given them, what have they learned? What are the unique gifts of the painful experiences that they've gained? And supporting young people in shifting the meaning that they're making from a person that is a victim to a person that has survived something, right? And is stronger and more powerful as a result. And so that sort of shifting the narrative and supporting them in making different meaning is a central component to our curriculum. We support young people in the self-care. It was so cool to hear about the self-care brunch. We do lots of fun self-care activities, just like the folks at Queen's Hope. Again, supporting young people in doing that, making soaps, making candles, learning about mantras, learning about body mapping, meditation, breathing exercises, all of these things. And also the young people have also introduced us to a term called squad care. We don't heal alone. We do nothing alone. We don't care for ourselves alone. And so what's the self-care, and also what's the squad care? How can we learn to take care of one another better? And so young people in group settings talk that through often. And then also restorative practices are at the center of our healing engaged approach. And so I'm gonna share a little bit more about restorative practice and restorative justice. Restorative practice, broadly speaking, is an ideology that can be used for building community, to achieve justice, for reintegration, for understanding, for celebration. It's a broad approach. Restorative justice, more specifically, is a restorative practice used specifically to address harms. So within our work, we hold and we utilize both approaches, wanting to name that restorative practice and restorative justice comes from our Indigenous siblings of this land. Incredibly important to name that this is a gift of the original stewards of this land. We now call it restorative justice, but it's an ancient way within the ways of Indigenous people, and we're grateful for this gift. Okay, so we use restorative justice within our organization to do a few things: to build community and promote healing amongst participants and staff, very important. Like, the work that we do with young people is a parallel process. If we're not engaged in those processes as staff and as folks doing the work, we're missing something. We got to sit in circle too. If we want the youth to sit in circle, we got to sit in circle. And so we sit in circle as staff as well. We host circles and do community circle keeping trainings in community. And we do some diversion and recidivism reduction work using restorative justice in collaboration with state actors in Miami-Dade County and in New York City. I'm going to take you to the website to learn more about that work. I'm not going to be able to go in depth on the diversion work, but it's very cool work that we do in partnership with the state. Okay, so some of the key elements of restorative practice is sitting in circle. We use a talking piece. The person with the talking piece is able to speak. We set values. So what you see in the photo here with the plates are the values. So the values are things like, listen with respect, listen from the heart. One person speaks at a time, honor pronouns, all those things are values. We have a center. So you see here also the young people are sitting around
what they're sitting around there, that's our center. On the center will be all kinds of things like the values, but also we include on our center things young people can engage with, like the oils, like squishy balls, like things they can doodle with, because that's important for engaging young people as well. And we also always have ritual opening and closing the space in a particular way, which is a trauma-informed practice. I'm looking at my time. Oh my goodness. 20 minutes felt like so much time. Okay. So there are all kinds of circles, talking circles, understanding circles, healing circles, et cetera. We utilize many of these types. I already named some of this, so I'm going to move on from this. And then, oh, yay. Okay. So I wanted to share a video. So it's important for at Soul Sisters that whenever I give a talk on things regarding young people, I always want to give youth voice. This young person's name is Kiara, and this is a brief video of her sharing about the impact of circles on her. Uh-oh. Is the sound working? I'm not here. It was working? Yes, Brittany? Okay, I'll keep playing. Oh, yeah. Oopsies, folks are saying they can't hear it. I can't hear it either. Can I get some tech help?
Can you try again now?
Sure I can, yeah. There we go.
RJ have changed my life by like, I can be myself. I can open up to people. Like they don't judge, everything is confidential. I feel safe. Like, I feel like it's a sisterhood around me. Like, I build bonds with people I didn't like at all before the group. We talk about it. Like, they respect your opinion. They come wholeheartedly. Like, they sincerely care. They always make sure we're, like, fed and stuff. Like, I really appreciate it. Like, RJ have really changed me. And, like, they made me, like, look at stuff differently. Like, things I used to think were cool, they made me realize, like what I was doing was wrong, better than like how I looked at it. So like, I'm learning how to like not give every reaction a reaction. So like, I really appreciate it.
Beautiful. So that's just a little bit from a young person on what these practices mean to her. Okay. So in the title of my talk, I talked about wanting to focus on healing, on social justice, and on culture. Okay, the slide deck has a mind of its own here. Okay, perfect, okay. So the social justice piece is really important. Within our programming, we teach young people about the systems that create the problems that the young people are experiencing, right? We live in a society where there's white supremacy, patriarchy, and economic exploitation are at the center of the society that we live in. And the legal system is a reflection of those systems of oppression. And we teach young people about that so that they understand that what they're experiencing isn't something isolated, that it's connected and woven into the fabric of the society, and that they actually have the ability to make a difference. It's by no accident that a dark-skinned girl doesn't feel beautiful. A dark-skinned girl doesn't feel beautiful because we live in a racist society that privileges the features of Europeans over the features of Africans. This is the society that we live in. And teaching young people about those histories and those legacies, sharing with them some of the language that can support them understanding their experience is incredibly valuable for their healing. And so we do things like we share with young people about what we call the four eyes of oppression. They learn some really critical sociological language that they would learn in college, in a college classroom, and then they do social action projects. And so you're seeing some photos of the social action projects young people have engaged in. And then, like I named, our work is incredibly culturally affirming. Our young people, there's a lot of twerking that goes on within our programs, y'all, a lot. And it's fantastic because we want young people to feel like they have a space to be free. They can do that without being over-sexualized. They can do that without being told that they're bad girls, that's actually just a form of dance and self-expression. We share with them about ancient cultural ways. There's a lot of art, there's a lot of joy, there's a lot of freedom in our work. And so I wanted to share a case study or a little impact statement about a young person, but my time is up. So instead of doing this, I'm going to say a couple of things that I think are the intervention around CSEC. Soul Sisters work promotes belonging, deep and meaningful connection with each other, with the girls have deep and mean, the young people have deep and meaningful connections with one another and with the adults in this space. Soul Sisters work deeply affirms young people. Young people are valued, seen, respected, honored, and celebrated. That's an intervention, that's a prevention strategy. Our work connects young people to resources. We support young people in getting jobs. We support young people by helping them. They travel with us. Our work, our organization also supports young people's learning. The learning young people are doing, they're learning about themselves. They're learning information that's relevant to their experiences in the world. And lastly, our work supports young people in making a difference. One of the things we hear a lot from young people is that they want to make sure that what happened to them doesn't happen to others. And so we create spaces for young people to do that. And that for us is the intervention, that's moving young people away from experiencing CSEC. Woo! Thank you so much for the opportunity to share.
Sorry about that, just struggling to unmute myself, but thank you so much, Wakumi. Even in your third slide, I was just writing down things and just always learning from the wonderful ways I think that you frame things. I would love it if folks could just throw some of their takeaways in there and I'll read some, but for me, I'm just really sitting with your values in the beginning. And I shared in the beginning of our presentation, we do a lot of values-based work, but I really loved the emotional justice. Everyone has the right to heal. I'm just sitting with that. And that is just so important. So thank you for that reminder for me and for everyone on the call. I'm just going to read through some of the chats for takeaways that other people have had. Bethany says, love the twerking and incorporating movement. That is so important. Let's see what else. Nice work. Really love the work that you are doing for the youth. It's so vital to have a purpose, as you revealed, with the healing-centered approach, which assists with the focusing around trauma experience. Folks are really loving the information around restorative justice circles and the squad care. That's something that I've been doing a lot of thinking about too, about how individualized self-care is, but the importance of community and collective care. So, and I love that they reframed it as squad care too. So I just really love that. So thank you for your offering today. And thank you to everyone who's presented so far. So what we're going to do now is I'm actually going to stop sharing the screen for a little bit so we can see our presenters, hopefully, and have an opportunity for you all to drop any questions that you may have of the presenters in the chat, and we can get some of those questions answered. And I think my friends at Youth Collaboratory can assist as well if there have been any questions that have been popping up in the chat as we've gone on. I haven't been able to read through it. The chat has been very, very active. So thank you all for your participation and just engagement with the training today.
Yeah, this has been amazing and so exciting. One of the first questions that we have is, does Queens Hope need volunteers?
Yes, Queens Hope is always actively looking for volunteers to come and support our young youth in programming.
Awesome. And we have dropped some links to these organizations and we will drop them again, but do know, feel free to reach out. Another question that we have is, how can we encourage judges in our city to create a dedicated calendar like the one that was shared?
I think it's a question oftentimes of resources. We know that courts are and feel overworked, have backlog, and there are lots of different opinions about whether or not we can or should create a dedicated calendar. Some people view it as too much, right? We can't have one calendar for every population. But I would encourage you to come forward and reach out to your bench with the community support. I think someone made a note in the chat during my conversation that it's not good just for the judges to go to the community, but for the community to tell the court what it is they need. So I think in terms of framing, every community, every county, every jurisdiction has their own culture. But I would say that to encourage your court to consider a dedicated calendar, having them reach out to the National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges, NCJ, FCJ, reaching out to California. I sit on the CSEC advisory board and action team for the California Child Welfare Council, encouraging them to reach out to those jurisdictions that have already done it. Sometimes it can feel overwhelming, like they have to create something out of whole cloth where they really don't have to reinvent the wheel. So to encourage your bench to say, hey, we are in the community and this is what we see that we need, encouraging your bench to reach out to those professional organizations that have already done this and literally we've created roadmaps, I think is often a way to sort of bridge that gap of the question about whether or not a dedicated calendar is important or effective or not.
Thank you for that, Judge. And there is one follow-up question for you there is, what are the suggested steps that a law student should take in their education to prepare to do similar work?
Be humble. Know that everyone doesn't know your story, so know that you don't know everyone else's story. Understand systems, understand youth development, understand adolescent brain development, understand trauma, both direct and secondary. Understand and have a real sense of what your personal capacity is. I think there are lots of very well-meaning, well-intentioned, both students and professionals that want to get into this work, and this is hard work. So you need to be honest with yourself about your experiences and things that might be triggering for you. And you might not even have expected that reaction. So it really takes some grounding in knowing yourself. And I think that that's a lifelong process, but really understanding the mechanics of youth and family dynamics, understanding trauma and their development are things that you can do in clinics that you can do through your law school program before you dive in.
Thank you for that, Judge. I'm hearing a theme of humility there and bringing, just normalizing that term in this work is so important. The next question is for the Queen's Hope team. Are there or what type of trainings would you suggest to help mentors meet youth where they're at?
Some of the trainings that we, are actually youth collaborative. We've attended several trainings with youth collaborative to be able to reach out to our mentors and provide insight and engagement strategies that can help them utilize it better in practice.
Awesome answer. Also, they could also reach out to you all directly and get some ideas about what's working and best practice and some of the amazing things that you all are doing. But thank you for that. Someone asked, how do you find organizations like these in your local community?
I'll go ahead and say attending community events, going to within schools, getting in contact with the bulletin boards, parent coordinators, just being in the community, going to different community sites where they can provide you resources to be able to identify particular service you're looking for.
Awesome, thank you. We have another one coming through. What are activities, this is for Wakumi. What are activities that we can do when we don't have funding to address identity-based oppression?
Oh goodness. I would send you to, there's a great book called Theater of the Oppressed by Augusto Boal, B-O-A-L. I would send you there. I would send you to, the name of the organization is escaping me. It's a California-based organization, School of Unity and Liberation, SOUL, in California. They do phenomenal trainings on how educating young people around these issues, School of Unity and Liberation out of California. And I always direct everybody to this book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, by Paulo Freire. It's an incredible book. I think if you're wanting to teach young people about issues of oppression, incredibly important. It's a little book, incredibly important to read this text. It's a seminal foundational text for this, for that educational work.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you for that. I see a few people sending some things on the way, but no. Can you repeat the name of the book, The Pedagogy of the Oppressed?
I see Brittany actually just put the link. So the link is in the chat to the book. Mm-hmm. Check it out. It's a great book.
Mm-hmm. And there is a question in the chat specifically to the judge. According to my research, many young individuals with intellectual disabilities are victims and they face difficulties at the court. How do you deal with those individuals?
So again, I think it's a function of knowing that and recognizing it. Sometimes the court won't know unless the lawyer or the advocate shares that with us. But once we have that identified, again, it's a function of reaching back out to that community and saying who can serve and support this particular youth. You know, being in Sacramento, like many of you in large urban areas, you have connections to schools, professional schools, education schools, medical schools, and they have staff. Who are working in these spaces, who have their own clinicals, who have their own dedicated clinicians. So I think that there are opportunities to reach out to professional organizations. But even if you are in a smaller community, we know that, and schools sometimes can struggle well with this, but schools also have dedicated counselors, teachers, and administrators who are steeped in assisting youth and young people with intellectual disabilities. So reaching out and saying, hey, we have a particular youth that is having difficulty navigating the system. How can we partner with you in a way that respects confidentiality, that's not violating information that the court doesn't need to know about the youth, but is recognizing, again, we can't do it alone. So reaching out to those entities, those persons, those spaces, those professionals, those community-based organizations that help support the youth and their families is what I would do. I would start with the schools. I would start with your professional schools, those clinicians, those clinics that are steeped in serving and supporting these youth.
Thank you so much, Judge, and thank you to all of our panelists. If we could spend the full day together, that would still not be enough time to soak up all of this wisdom and good energy. But unfortunately, our time is coming to a close. I'm going to pass it on to our colleague, Lenore, and Brittany to get us moving on to our next steps.
Thank you all again, and just want to echo what Joy said. This has just been a phenomenal training. I've learned so much, even though I've known some of the speakers before and heard them speak before, but this is just so, so phenomenal. And I just want to thank you all for participating and all the participants for engaging and asking questions and being curious about how to better support our girls. So I just want to share the contact information for all of our panelists. I think some folks were asking for that before. So these are the email addresses and then the websites for Soul Sisters and Queens Community Justice Center. And there's not a specific website for the court that the judge had mentioned, but we are going to add in the chat and send also after this some two resources that the judge shares. One of them focuses on specialized courts and a dedicated calendar. So those will be shared in the chat for you to have access to. And then finally, just another opportunity for you to join our listservs, the Center for Court Innovation. You can join our listserv here, and we'll drop the link in the chat. And if you want to learn more about our trafficking initiatives, I think I had mentioned one that we have called Project Heal on survivor leadership, you can feel free to reach out to me. That's my email address, and I'll pass it to Lenore for Youth Collaboratories information.
Thank you so much, Brittany. Again, thank you to all of our phenomenal speakers for providing such critical resources and information. Today, we celebrated cultural humble service delivery, we centered lived expertise, and we honored healing. So we will be sending out the recording of today's presentation and the contact information for Youth Collaboratory and the Center for Court Innovation, along with all of our phenomenal speakers. So please stay connected. And again, to be a part of our listserv or for more information on how to become a member, please visit our websites. So in the chat, you're going to find the evaluation for today's presentations. Please complete the evaluation link and in the chat and let us know your thoughts on today's webinar. Again, happy Black History Month. Happy Black Girl Freedom Week. We hope that you all just enjoyed yourself today and journey well. Thank you. Thank you.
wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, and something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be,
yeah,
a lovely day. When someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Look at you, and I know it's gonna be.